Good morning. I'm Sandra Cox, and I'm the pastor of Faith Formation here at St. Paul's, and I am glad to be able to welcome you to worship with us this morning. If you're worshiping with us online, we're really glad you're here, and we'd love to know that you are here. Please take a moment to sign in the attendance pad or let us know in the comments that you are here. If this is the first time that you've worshiped with us this morning, if this morning is the first time that you've worshiped with us, I want to extend a special greeting and welcome to you. And I want to let you know that we would love to help you find your place in this community where we love, seek, and serve together. There are a few things I want to share with you as we begin this morning. I would like to acknowledge that last Sunday was our first Sunday food drive, and I want to thank everybody who brought food that we'll share with our ministry partners. I'm looking out in the lobby, and I see that it was a very well attended and well received morning. So I'm grateful for all that you did, all that you brought. I'm also grateful for all of you who helped to egg a family this Easter season. There were many of you who made a surprise Easter egg hunt on the front lawns of some of our families with children. And later this week, we'll start posting some photos of the kids as they were doing those Easter hunts. It was a great joy for them, and it was very well received. And so thank you to everyone who participated in that. I also want to share my excitement with you about the plans that we have to return to worship in person, outdoors, and that will be starting April 25th. And as a way to prepare for that, we're inviting you to come and be part of some gatherings on the grounds here starting April 13th. That's this Tuesday. You can sign up for that as a way to come and gather and visit with a pastor and let's check in with how it's been for you, how you have been able to nourish your faith through this year. And then we'll invite you into the building where we're going to ask if you would to help us bless the space where we will do ministry together. And you'll be able to go from room to room and pray over the ministry that will happen there. It would be a really great to see everybody. So I want to encourage you, the details and the sign-up link were in the newsletter this past Friday. So if you haven't had a chance to look at it, now would be a good time to look at that and sign up for an opportunity to come and gather and visit with us and let us know how excited you are about in-person worship that will resume on April 25th. We'll have a 9:30 and an 11 o'clock service, 9:30 contemporary service outside, 11 o'clock traditional service outside. There will also be an option for a traditional service online at 8:15, and then we will release a recording of the contemporary service at 5 p.m. on Sunday, so that whether you are excited about worshiping in person or online, you have opportunities to do both traditional and contemporary. So with all that being said, the excitement is that it is the week after Easter, and the good news is still true. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Let's bring ourselves and open our hearts to worship this morning.
Happy Easter season. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. The joy of Easter still sings in our hearts. Breathe the breath of new life in your spirits. We open our hearts to all wondrous work God has for us to do. Welcome to worship this glorious day. Let our lives be a testimony to God's redeeming love. Amen.
Join us in our opening hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Crown Him with many crowns, the Lamb upon His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of Him who died for thee, and hail Him as thy matchless King through all eternity. Crown Him with Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave, and rose victorious in the strife for those He came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring and lives that death may die. Crown Him the Lord of love, behold His hands and side, those wounds yet visible above in beauty glorified. All hail, Redeemer, hail, for Thou hast died for me. Thy praise and glory shall not fail throughout eternity.
Please join me in the affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Our scripture this morning comes to us from the Gospel according to John, and it is the account of what took place on the evening of that first Easter morning. And just to set this in context, that morning Mary Magdalene had gone to the tomb and she found that the stone had been rolled away. And she went and got Peter and the other disciple and brought them back with her. And they looked in to see that his body was gone and they both headed for home. John doesn't say why exactly. He just says they don't stick around. But Mary remains in that darkened cemetery, and she questions strangers, and she searches for the missing body of her Lord. And she encounters Jesus himself. And while she mistakes him for the groundskeeper, he reminds her that he is the caretaker of so much more. And he gives her an assignment, her very first post-resurrection commission. Go and tell all the others that I'm back and that I'm on my way to my Father as I said I would be. She did just that and shared that news with all the disciples. Will there be celebrating? Will there be rejoicing? Will there be alleluias? Will there be Christ is risen? He is risen indeed. Let's find out. And hear the passage from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19 through 29. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." May God add blessing and meaning to the reading and hearing of these words. Now, I need to be honest with you, and I need to tell you that this isn't the first time that I have preached a sermon on this passage. It comes up often on the Sunday right after Easter. And I have preached often on the Sunday right after Easter. So yes, I did pull out all those old sermons just to have a little look and see if, well, you know, maybe there's something worth repeating there. And what I found, without exception, was that each time I've preached on this passage, I have focused on the fact that the disciples chose to respond to the good news of the resurrection by locking themselves away in a room behind a locked door. And I have chastised them for locking themselves away. I guess I wanted them, in the face of all this good news, I wanted them to accept it as good news and embrace this new reality and celebrate with each other and make plans for how they were going to share this news with other people. You know, just be the church. I wanted them not to be afraid. I wanted them to be busy because I know that there's work to be done. But all the times that I have read this passage before, all the times that I have preached a message on this passage before, this is the first time I have done so in the midst of a global pandemic. And suddenly, locking yourself away in a house for fear of what's out there doesn't seem all that strange to me. It seems not a lot different than how I felt about a year ago when I found out that there was a virus on the loose out there that we didn't know that much about, except that it could be potentially deadly and it was wildly contagious. A year ago, all I knew was that things that had been part of my everyday life before, like shaking hands and hugging and standing next to somebody. Now, those all were things that were dangerous to me, dangerous for all of us. And really, the safest place to be was at home, locked away from the rest of the world. So this morning, to you, who might have heard my previous sermons, and to John's disciples, I apologize. I think I wasn't feeling the full weight of all that was going on for you. I wasn't tuning in to the way your lives had changed so drastically in just one day. I wasn't seeing how you had to navigate a whole new reality now, and you weren't sure how you were going to do that, and you needed some time, and you needed a safe place to think about how to do that. Because now you were going to have to generate new definitions of what faithful living looked like. And I know that I wasn't acknowledging the depth of your grief in all that you had lost and how that could generate a lot of fear for what comes next. So for my arrogance and my snarkiness, I apologize. And I will try to do better by you. Like trying to understand how fear had a power over you. And trying to understand exactly what you were afraid of. Regrettably, John says it was the Jews. I say regrettably because for much too long, John's use of the phrase the Jews and the way the Jewish people are portrayed in John's narrative have caused a great deal of harm, and it has fostered anti-Semitism in the cruelest of ways. We can't hear, I can't speak John's words and not think about marchers in the 2017 far-right rally in Charlottesville, Virginia, who chanted, "Jews will not replace us," or the shooter in the 2018 Pittsburgh synagogue shooting, who killed 11 people. And I for sure can't hear John's words without thinking about my friend Judy in the third grade, who once asked me, "Will your parents let me be friends with you?" "Why wouldn't they?" I asked. I was kind of a shy kid, and my parents were always glad if I made a friend. And she said, "Because I'm Jewish, and you're Christian, and Christians believe that we killed Jesus." She was 8, and she was carrying that burden already. I don't want to add to that kind of harm, so I'm not going to try to translate for you just who the Jews might refer to in John's narrative. I can't redeem John's words here, and I won't try, but I can say I'm sorry and that I don't want to participate or continue any kind of harm at all. So I'll focus on what I do know about the disciples. And what I do know is that they were very afraid. And fear is real. And I know this, that when we let it get the best of us, fear can paralyze us. And that is, I believe, what the locked door can mean for us in this story. The barricade that fear puts in our way when we let it. It's what keeps us from doing what we know we're called to do, but we don't have the courage to do it, or the confidence in ourselves to do it, or even worse, we don't believe enough in what God can do through us. But the power of this story, the way John tells it, is that just as the disciples were cowering in their fear, and fear was paralyzing them behind a locked door, Jesus came and stood among them. And he brought them peace. He showed them his wounds. And he gave them the power to reveal God's presence in the world. And then he breathed on them the Holy Spirit, the breath that would animate them back to life, mobilize them out of their fear. And he does the same thing again. Jesus does the same thing again for Thomas a week later. John doesn't say why Thomas wasn't there the week before with all the others. He just wasn't there. So when he does join them in the following week, it gives the disciples a chance to practice what Jesus had commissioned them to do, to proclaim that God, through Jesus, is in their midst. And they did it beautifully. They did it with passion and power. And they said to Thomas, "We have seen the Lord." But somehow they couldn't convince Thomas. And I think it's more about them than it is about Thomas. For after all, they didn't believe Mary Magdalene when she told them that she had seen the Lord either. They couldn't convince Thomas just by their words that Christ was alive. And it seems he needed the same thing that they needed, which was to experience for himself the power and the presence of the risen Christ, scars and all, and have him breathe on him his peace and his passion. And when he does, suddenly, instead of these paralyzed, frightened individuals, they become a bold community of faith, empowered by the Holy Spirit, and led back out into the world again to share and give witness to the life that God offers. A world that wasn't the same as it was when they hid themselves behind that locked door, but a world that needed to hear this message all the more. They were able to leave that room, I believe, and they did it because Jesus, well, because Jesus is Jesus, but in John's world, Jesus has already told us something very important that's a clue here. 10 chapters ago, Jesus told us that he is the door that leads to life. We hear it most often in Scripture translated as, "I am the gate," but that's most likely because Jesus was using a shepherd and sheep metaphor, and a gate would make more sense in English. But if we were reading the New Testament in Greek, we would clearly hear Jesus say that he is the thura, which is a door. And it would be for us this image that is life-giving and offering direction and protection and provision. Jesus is a thura, just like the thura that the disciples are now locked behind. So here we have it, I think, a contrast of two doors, a choice of which door will offer us the most abundant life. The door that looks like it offers us safety at first, protecting us from what we're afraid of, but really just keeps us trapped in a place where we get more and more focused on our fear. Or the other door, the door that is really Jesus and offers us a way out of fear, a way out of confusion, and instead gives us peace and life and purpose, and fills us with courage and confidence to live as a bold faith community. What are the doors that you are locked behind right now? What are the barricades between you and an abundant life? Maybe you have said things that can't be taken back, and you're afraid you can never be forgiven, and that is paralyzing a relationship. Or maybe you have spent some time during pandemic reassessing your priorities, and you want to make a shift in your life, but you don't know if you can live with the changes that would result from that. Or maybe you are overwhelmed with what lies beyond your door, what lies outside, the division and the racism and the violence, and you wonder, how could you do anything that would make a difference at all? John invites us to believe that Jesus can meet us where we are and unlock the fear that paralyzes us. Believe that God can work through you and be patient with yourself. Resurrection takes time. It doesn't happen in one day or even a week. I don't know how long it took the disciples to be brave enough to walk out into their new life, but I do know that Jesus was there for them every moment, every step of the way, strengthening their resolve and giving them the courage that they needed. St. Paul's, I think finding our way in the world post-pandemic is going to take some time too, for us as individuals and for us as a congregation. I once heard William Willimon speak at a preacher's conference. Willimon is a retired United Methodist bishop and tells a great story, many great stories. And the one that I remember from that meeting was the story of his first appointment as a pastor. He was a student going to seminary, and he drove up to that church on that first day so excited to be greeted by the chair of the board, the church council. And he found there on the front door a big chain and padlock with a big sign that said, "Keep out." And the board chair told him that the local sheriff, had put that sign up there. And Willimon asked, "Why?" And the board chair told him, "Well, you know, things got a little out of hand at the board meeting last month. Folks started just coming in the sanctuary, ripping up carpet, dragging out the pews that they had given in memory of their mothers or their grandfathers. It got bad. The sheriff had to come out here and put that there lock on the door until our new preacher could come and settle things down." Willimon said that rather typified his time at that church. He says he spent a year there that lasted a lifetime. He tried everything. He worked and he planned, he taught, and he begged. But the response was always the same. There were arguments, there was pettiness, there were fights in the parking lot after the board meeting, and it was more than he could take. And so after a year, he was really glad to leave them. And he remembers driving away from the church and looking at it in his rearview mirror and muttering, "You call yourself a church?" And then a couple of years later, while he was visiting at Emory University, he ran into a student who told him that he was now serving that church. And Willimon's heart just went out to him. He thought, "Oh, such a dear young man, and he's only 23 to have to do that." And the student told Willimon, "You know, they still remember you out there." And Willimon said, "Yeah, I remember them too." The student said, aren't they a remarkable bunch of people?" And Willimon said, "Remarkable? In what way?" And the student went on to say, "Well, their ministry to the community has just been such a wonder. That little church is now supporting, in one way or another, more than a dozen of the troubled families that live around the church. And the free daycare center is going great. And, you know, there just aren't too many interracial congregations like them in North Georgia." Philemon could hardly believe what he was hearing. "What happened?" he asked. And the student said, "Oh, I don't know. One Sunday, things just sort of came together. It wasn't anything in particular. It's just that when the service was done, we were on our way out, and we just knew, that Jesus loved us and had a plan for us. Things just took off after that." Willimon went on to say to us who were gathered there for that meeting, he said, I tell you what I think happened. I think that church got intruded on. I think someone greater than me knocked the lock off that door, kicked it open, and offered them peace. Offered them the Holy Spirit and a mission and forgiveness. And now," Willimon said, "they are really called church." The good news of Easter in this passage is that tombs can't hold Jesus, and locked rooms filled with fear can't hold us either. The risen Christ of passion and power finds a way into our locked rooms of fear and offers us a way out. And he invites us to do the same for others. Peace be with you, says Jesus. Receive the Holy Spirit. And then let me set you loose on the world. Amen. We have a chance now to respond to God through the word that we heard. We have a chance to respond in prayer. Maybe, and to light a candle this morning as you pray. And maybe you need to light a candle for that room that is keeping you locked and paralyzed. And maybe you need to feel and sense and see the light of Christ in that fear. Or maybe you know someone who is locked and paralyzed in fear or confusion, and you can light a candle for them and pray for them. And we also can respond to God's call in our life through generosity. I invite you to give this morning. You can go online, stpaulslenexa.org/give. You can text to give. Directions for submitting an offering will be in the comments this morning. But as you respond through your generosity, remember that you are helping to open a door for someone else through the ministry of this congregation to find hope and to find a new way of life in the world. So let us go to God now in prayer and generosity.
Come by here, my Lord, come by here. Come by here, my Lord, come by here. Come by here, my Lord, come by here. Oh, someone's praying, Lord, come by here, oh, come by here. Someone's praying, Lord, come by here, oh, come by here. Someone's praying, Lord, come by here, oh, come by here, oh, Lord, come by here. Someone's crying, Lord, come by here. Someone's crying, Lord, come by here, oh, come by here. Someone's crying, Lord, come by here. Oh, here. sing in the evening, Lord, in my waking, in my sleeping, in my pleading, waiting, caring, Lord, in my loving, in my grieving, in my hoping, longing, healing, falling, Lord, you are here. In my aching, breathing, dying, rising, Lord, you are here. By here, my Lord, come by here, O Lord, you are here. Bless the gifts our hands have brought, and bless the work our hearts have planned. Ours is the faith, the will, the thought. The rest, O God, is in your hand.
Will you pray with me? God of grace and peace, you walk with us on our journey. You comfort us when we grieve. You heal our hearts when they are broken. And you give us hope in fearful times. You are our shepherd and a light to the world. Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit so that we may have faith and life abundant. And hear us, O God, as we pray together as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Join us in our closing hymn, He Lives.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever foes may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He is always near. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Amen. You ask me how I know He lives. I know because I have been locked away by fear before and confusion and doubt, and somehow I found a way out. And it wasn't on my own. It could only be the power of Christ Jesus, the risen Savior. And so let's go from here, St. Paul's, to find our purpose in the world and to serve that world, knowing that we go with the love of a Creator God, passion of a risen Savior, and the power of the Holy Spirit that leads us this day and every day. Amen.